Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. We welcome you to US-Japan Research Institute event. The subject is China. And before starting our discussion and presentation, I would like to introduce USJI. What we're doing. We are the one of the NGO established in 2009, with the objective of raising the volume of voices discussed in Japan, presented in Japan, and in the United States. The group established this USJI consists of five universities, interestingly, competing universities from West, Rikyo, no, not Rikyo, Ritsumeikan, Kyoto, I see Kyoto University, and Keio, Todai, and Waseda. I'm Waseda's university professor. I'm operating at Waikiki. So let me introduce Professor Matsuda, who is our main speaker. And our discussion is Ms. Tatsumi. And let's welcome them. Okay, Professor Matsuda, for yours.
Thank you, Professor Abe. Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Yasuhiro Matsuda from the University of Tokyo. I'm doing research on China and Taiwan-related issues and international relations, especially focusing on politics and security issues in East Asia. USJI to give me such a great opportunity to give a speech on Japan-China relations. Yeah. And I have just arrived today, and this trip was actually funded by the friends of Todai. And I'm going to go to Yale University tomorrow and give another speech, and also appreciate the Todai for giving me this opportunity. Today's topic is today's topic is Sino-Japanese security relations, concerns, competition, and communication. My questions and concerns are these. The characteristics of the security environment in East Asia, and what are the characteristics of the Sino-Japanese security relations? And both sides have different concerns to each other, and what are the concerns, and what are the major trends in the relationship. Firstly, I like to sum up the characteristics of this region. I think that the East Asia is still a modern world. Basically, the nation states are very strong, and people are very, very busy with modernization and making money. And there are so many troubles, such as territorial issues, territorial disputes, and divided nations, such as Korea and China, Taiwan. And there is a very weak multilateral security arrangement, and but still very strong security ties between U.S. and other nations. This is a very welcome map in Japan. It's a little different. Actually, this idea started during the Cold War period, and you know, it shows that the characteristics of East Asia, the continental Asia, Asian countries such as Russia and China, are, you know, surrounded by the island chain. Which is, this is the first island chain, and this is the second island chain. So, the, you know, if Russia and China, continental Asian countries, big countries, want to go out to the Pacific, they have to go through these island chains. And Japan, Taiwan, Philippines, and other maritime ocean Southeast Asian countries are all partners of the United States. So there is a clear distinction of the maritime Asia and continental Asia. This is a geostrategic situation. Let me start to describe the security relationship between China and Japan. The relation made a very big change during the late Cold War period, especially, you know, after the U.S.-China rapprochement in the beginning of the 1970s. Before that, Japan and China was in a war situation, some Japanese war, Korean War, and Vietnam War. And these are wars fought by China and Japan, or China and the United States. But Japan was always standing opposite to China. But the wars ended. And in the 1970s, both countries normalized its relations and signed the Treaty of Peace and Friendship. Then the security relations began. Both countries exchanged the military attaché in 1974. Before that, both of them are really, really felt very sensitive about talking any military-related issues, because both of them fought very fiercely. And especially the Chinese side didn't want to have any kind of military conflict. But after 1974, it began. The approach from both sides was based on the strategic positive factor that was in existence of Soviet Union. At that time, China had a rivalry relationship with Soviet Union. But Japan has a little bit different situation. Japan doesn't want a serious confrontation against Soviet Russia. Japan also has a very serious issue, such as the Northern Territory issue. And Japan needs more energy resources. Japan has been always dependent on energy in the Middle East, but Japan wanted to have another choice. So Japan's relations with Russia and China's relations with Russia are quite different. At that time, China wanted Japan to fight against Russia, but Japan didn't want it. But anyway, the existence of Russia, the Soviet, was a positive, a kind of positive factor to put them together. But there are also negative factors. For example, Chinese potential criticism against Japanese, quote unquote, military. And also, Japanese pessimism, also a negative factor to put them together. Why? Because Japan doesn't export any arms. So it is banned in the 1970s. Okay? And no technology, military technology transfer. These are what China wanted. But Japan couldn't give them at all. And no military advisory groups. Japan has not sent any military advisory groups after the World War II. Nowadays, Japan has made just a little bit changed. Japan has sent retired self-defense force personnel to Southeast Asia for capacity building assistance. Name is quite different, but in the past it was named military advisory group. Basically, Japan doesn't do that kind of thing. And China cannot take advantage by dealing with Japan. Japan is too passive. Japan's pacifism was so strong. And at that time, China's expectation with Japan was very high. So in some time, Chinese official said that Japan should raise its defense budget to 2%, which is 1% is not unofficial. However, in 1985, Prime Minister Nako Sone's so-called formal visit to the Yasukuni Shrine made a strong impact on the So the China's expectation toward Japan, strategic expectation toward Japan, became very high for a moment and failed. And after that, in 1989, Tiananmen Square Incident happened. And both countries virtually stopped almost all the exchanges related to the military. And however, Japan wants China's stability, so Japan sent its emperor to China in 1992. So the both countries warmed up its security relations again. So in 1993-95, they revived high-level business. Getting into the post-Cold War period. During the 1990s, they began to revitalize the defense exchanges. However, the goals of China and Japan are quite different. China's goals are described like this. Of course, China has not formally said this kind of thing, but the people like Ken Allen, a very famous
China Watcher
described this way. The China's goals is first gathering intelligence on JSDF and US forces in Japan. Trying to erode self-defense forces, support for the alliance with the United States. Three, understand Japan's defense planning and thinking. Four, learning how Japan manages its military. Five, contributing to Japanese relations. So basically, goals are kind of intelligence related. Actually, most of the defense exchanges are related to intelligence information gathering. Japan's goal is also the same, but as for Japan, the defense exchanges is a part of engagement policy for China, and also to improve transparency of both sides. Japan tries to open up China. Japan tries to make China more transparent, and also Japan wants to show the transparency of the U.S.-Japan alliance and its, Japan's own defense capability, and try to reassure China. So this is a very difficult, different thing. Japan's goal, one of Japan's goals is to create transparency. And after that, after the Korean Peninsula's crisis and Taiwan Strait crisis, Japan began to, Japan and the United States began to enhance security arrangement. However, the defense exchanges between Japan and China have many, many problems. The very big incident of Prime Minister Clinton's Yastin Shrine visit. After his visit to the shrine, for example, the Director General of the JDA, again, Nakatani. It's not general. His name, first name. Again, Nakatani's visit about only a few days before the departure, and also a big delay of mutual port calls. It was agreed in 1998, but it materialized in 2007. Both sides waited almost 10 years. So during the Koizumi's era, China had a very difficult time to deal with Japan. So there is a kind of description that the defense exchanges between Japan and China is a kind of safety valve in order to save the whole relations. China always cut. The defense exchanges, then China can show the unpleasant feeling, or then the other areas such as economic exchanges can go on. This is a safety valve theory. Why the defense exchanges become such a vulnerable part of the whole relations? Because, as I said a little while ago, Japan's tools are quite limited. We never sell weapons. We never transfer technology. We never enhance the defense capability of China. So this is, this is what China doesn't like. So there is no actual benefit for China and Japan. That is why the defense exchange is always symbolic ones and easy to cut. So the symbolic exchanges like high-level visits are always very, very well-known. However, the working level exchanges and second track exchanges tend not to be cut. This is what I said, actually. The all these items are basically the high-level exchanges. And there are some working level talks and mutual port calls. Mutual port calls are also very symbolic ones. So actually, the Sino-Japanese security exchanges are very much symbolic ones and very few actual contacts. During the post Cold War period, both sides increased its concerns, their concern against each other. There is a list of concerns of Japanese side. In Japan, there was a concern, especially after the Tiananmen Square incident in 1989, there was a big concern that China may collapse sometime. So weak China was a big concern, very much worrisome. Far before that, during the Cultural Revolution, the failed state is also a very big concern. Take a look at this. There is four different scenarios. If China becomes modernized itself, or if China stagnates, or if China becomes if China becomes a cooperative state, or unilateral state, or hegemonic state. So there are four different types of China we can take. In the first stage, Japan was worried about failed state. Very dangerous state. Later on, Japan became very much worrisome about China becoming a rogue state, launching missiles against Taiwan and doing a lot of wrong things. And of course, Japan wants China to become cooperative power. Japan and China become much more cooperative and organized and linked with world economy. And hopefully become much more mobile. This is the best scenario. And this may be the worst hegemonic power. China becomes a much more modernized country and behave in that way. So this is the concern, major concern. And now, the Japanese public are very much worried about the last one, the hegemonic, China becoming hegemonic. Especially after 2005, Japanese public have witnessed anti-Japanese demonstrations and some other related events. People carry banners like "Die Japanese," "Damn Japanese," and that kind of thing. So the Japanese public also already have such kind of feeling. And China's maritime development, both East China Sea and South China Sea, is also very much worrisome. these are the copy of the latest China security report. China's maritime activities in 2010. The China's fleet made a round trip, and the fleet comes here and doing some activities. And these activities are carefully watched by the maritime forces. This is the map. China has made a military maneuver around here. And the Japanese authorities think that this is this kind of military activities are aiming at the US naval force around here. And this is called anti-access. Area denial operations. This is the map of East China Sea. This is a joint development area. And these are petroleum sites. In the year 2008, both China and Japan made an agreement on joint development here. And Chinese companies welcome Japanese investment on the petroleum development. But nothing has happened so far. But Chinese side have already begun to operate this petroleum already. So these are pretty much big concerns for the Japanese public and the government. And also, risk of accidental collisions is becoming bigger and bigger. For example, during this kind of operation, Japanese Maritime Self-Defense Force and also Japanese Maritime Safety Agency ships tries to see Chinese fleets. And sometimes Chinese helicopters try to access, try to approach to the Japanese vessels. And in some cases, only 30 meters distance. So it's very, very dangerous. Only 1 or 2 second helicopter can glide at a Japanese vessel. So this kind of thing has happened several times in this area. Modernization, low transparency, and Taiwan issue, and so on. So these are Japanese concerns. Especially, just 10 days ago, a Chinese ship, official ship, was sent to the Senkaku water, and the official said that we sent this ship in order to break Japan's effective control over the islands. And this is a very strong announcement. It means that China is going to change its status quo. Of course, before that, Japan has changed its maritime safety agencies related legislation. For example, if these fishermen land to the remote islands, such as Sengkaku Islands, in the past, the officials of maritime safety agency couldn't land and arrest these people. That's why, in the case of 2003, fishermen landed on the Senkaku Island. Then they use helicopter and bring policemen to the island and then arrest the people. So it was very, very ineffective. So recently, Japan changed the law. It allows the maritime safety agency's officials can arrest the people of illegal landing to the Japanese islands. And China may take it very, very provocative. Japan also named some remote islands which didn't have names. And these islands include some islands in Senkaku Island. And China also took it very much provocative. So this action could be a kind of retaliation, a reaction against Japanese action. However, this is a very, very, anyway, this is a very, very strong. On the other hand, the Chinese also have many, many concerns against Japan. For example, the Chinese biggest concern is about Taiwan. During the 1990s and 2000s, the cross-strait relations between the mainland China and Taiwan became very much tense. At that time, US-Japan alliance could play a big role to intervene over the Taiwan Strait and stop China attacking Taiwan. That was a nightmare for China. So for many, many times, China has checked Japan, that, saying that don't intervene on Taiwan issue. Okay. However, from the 1990s, the new defense guideline, situation area surrounding Japan, this kind of things have got materialized. And also, Japan-Taiwan relations are becoming better and better. In Taiwan, there is an opinion poll that asking Taiwanese people, which country do you like best? The answer is Japan, 54%. That's very, very high. The second country which Taiwan is like best is United States, 8%. And the third one is China, 5%. So the relations between Japan and Taiwan is very, very good, very stable. It has a very stable base. And these things are very much a serious concern for China. And the trend of the enhancement of US-Japan alliance, it means encirclement of China. This kind of discourse was told many, many times. And Japan's rearmament, this discourse is also told many times. Japan has a historical burden. Japan invaded China and killed a lot of people and did a lot of wrong things. So as for the ordinary Chinese people, Japan is a country of military skill. For example, the most famous Japanese is still Hideki Tojo. he is top three, still at least top three. He is the famous, most famous Japanese. Recently, some Japanese, you know, singers became top one or top two. But these are image of the Chinese public. You know, Japan has a strong military, and it's stronger. It's becoming stronger and stronger. Japan's defense budget is, you know, booming. And Japan and the United States is trying to encircle China. This militaristic image. And this book is a little bit different. This book is does not necessarily mean that Japan is reviving, but these are images of Japan, which the Chinese carry. Okay. And also, missile defense deployment is also very negative to China, because it may neutralize the Chinese minimum deterrence. I think that China also has four different views on China, on Japan. For example, if Japan keeps keeps dependent on the United States, or if Japan become independent from the United States, there are two different directions. And Japan stays developing, and Japan keeps declining. So if Japan keeps dependent on the United States, keeps its development, the US-Japan alliance will become strong. And if Japan declines slowly and more dependent on the United States, it's a weak but still alliance. And both are bad for China. If Japan keeps development and independent from the United States, it's also very bad. It's a revival of militarism. Japan will have its own nuclear weapons and try to control over Asia by itself. So three out of four scenarios are very much worrisome. It's same for Japan. Japan's scenarios on China and China's scenarios on Japan are very, very similar. Three out of four are worrisome. And the last one is not likely. Okay? Japan declines and becomes independent from the United States. It means some Japanese coalition or East Asian community. Okay? This is not likely to happen. So both China and Japan have their own concerns with each other. And concerns are real. Concerns are real. And the only scenario which is not worrisome is not likely to happen. This is the situation on both sides. I have talked about the more bilateral ones, but here, with regional, both countries' engagement with the regional security. First one is Taiwan. I also mentioned a little bit about Taiwan and the U.S. Taiwan relations. Taiwan Relations Act implies that the United States may intervene if China attacks Taiwan. This is remain ambiguous. This is called strategic ambiguity. And this is a very cheap strategy because the United States is very strong.
So if it intervenes, then China won't attack Taiwan, because China will lose. But the United States never says that it will intervene. That's why Taiwan will also have to be very, very cautious. Taiwan cannot provoke. Okay. So this is a very well thought strategy. Okay. However, there is a possibility that the United States may intervene. It means that Japan could get entangled by this warfare. And Japan also passed the law on the situation areas around Japan. It means that when some situation which may severely influence the peace and stability of Japan, Japan and the United States tries to deal with it, military tries to deal with it, then Japan can give real area support. Of course, it doesn't include weapons and ammunition, and it should be done in the non-combat area, but still, the people take it as ordinary military logistical support. So Japan will get entangled. If Taiwan Strait contingency happens. Okay. In that case, Japan has three options, or Japan has to face three situations. One is evacuation of the Japanese. So far, still almost 20 to 30,000 Japanese citizens are living and traveling in Taiwan. So if something happens, Japan has to evacuate them. And there are more than 200,000 Japanese citizens are living in southern China. So and they also have to escape. And this is a serious situation. Only 10 years ago, the number was not that big. It became almost 10 times bigger. I was really shocked when I checked the number. It became 10 times more within 10 years. So this is a huge operation if Japan really wants to do it. Okay. Second, to allow US use its bases in Japan, that to authorize that this situation, that this military attack is a situation that is and support the extension. These three activities can be seen as a very, very provocative actions by China. It will invite a serious reaction from China. Okay. So in Taiwan situation, that is the situation of the US-Japan dealing with China. But the other regional security issue is North Korea. And I think that time is running up, so I will briefly do that. Okay. There are many things to talk about. Basically, China's attitude to Korean Peninsula is stability first. So the priorities are different from other countries. For example, in Japan, denuclearization and remove the missiles and also abduction issues are very important. So Japan wants these issues sometimes at the cost of the stability of the Korean Peninsula. But China wants stability first. Under the basis of stability, China wants demilitarization, removing the missiles, and maybe abduction, very low. So basically, China is, China will try to deal with this situation with the basis of stability. So although China holds six-party talks and try to deal with the North Korean nuclear issues, basically, I don't think that this is going to be solved. The last one is question management. Because the Japan-China relations have become very much tense in these days, and Chinese maritime activities, naval, especially naval development and maritime activities, become very much large scale. And the same cartoons tell it out. Conflict also become a kind of platform. Both sides began to realize that they need a kind of crisis management mechanism. There are many, many conferences and also many scholars made proposals and appeals to help to let them have crisis management mechanism. Now that military hotlines are discussed, and also there is a joint working group for founding the maritime liaison mechanism between the two countries. There are two meetings. This meeting was held. Has been held. This, however, it takes a very long time, and if we think about the situation, you know, exists in between the United States and China, and hotline issue, it doesn't work well because basically China's decision making system is very much closed. And we don't really know who is in charge, and who is powerful, and who is responsible. In that situation, the hotline doesn't really work. And maritime liaison mechanism. What kind of maritime liaison mechanism? Maybe this also implies the necessity of hotline, but if they really want to set up this kind of hotlines, they can do that very quickly. It has passed more than 3 years to talk about this. So I think that this is not likely to be established in an effective way. As I said before, I'm not that optimistic about the relations between Japan and China, but there is still very little room between two countries. For example, I think that especially the UNPKO and anti-piracy relations. Look at this map. Both China and Japan have sent their vessels to Aden Gulf and water near Somalia. And both of them have not made any cooperation with each other. And this is very ineffective. In Europe, many militaries, many countries' militaries help each other, support each other, and do the similar operations. But in East Asia, this kind of thing has not happened. And China has sent many, many troops for UN peacekeeping operations and Japan is now doing the same thing. So I think that both countries can find a room for cooperation. So this is my conclusion. I think that basic structure in East Asia has not changed greatly. The land balance versus sea balance, this kind of structure has not changed. I think that this kind of rivalry will continue. And Sino-Japanese security relations is a dependent variable. But the very much large scale structure changes the Sino-Japanese security relations. Sino-Japanese security relations will not change the structure. And there is a strong vulnerability caused by historical burden and lack of strategic trust between two countries. And many actions are taken by China. China is very much active, but Japan is very much reactive. Japan is not an independent actor. Japan is always worrying about US reaction. And Japan doesn't have many, many tools to deal with China in the military field. And both sides have different interests in regional security issues. And my suggestion is that the Japan-China security relations you have to receive from only symbolism-related relations and target for much more concrete and especially in crisis management operations. Now this is my conclusion. Thank you very much.
So as you all heard, Japan-China security relations are very complex. And then I think the complexity comes from the fact that on one hand, there are a host of security concerns that Japan holds toward China, and China holds toward Japan. So concerns are mutual. And he covered very eloquently where those concerns come from, so I won't repeat them. So there, on the one hand, there are a lot of security concerns that Japan and China hold against each other. But on the other hand, the two countries, it is not possible for two countries to completely sever ties. They both live in live in the same neighborhood, East Asia. They're both very interdependent, particularly in its economy. And for better or for worse, there are security concerns that Japan holds very dear to its security, its national interests, such as in North Korea, that really requires cooperation with China. And that's, I think, where the fundamental complexity of this relationship is. And I won't go into the lack of strategic mistrust and other issues, since I've already covered them. But when you think about the security relationship between the US and China, you see the similar complexities, but often actually very magnified and actually complicated by the issue of Taiwan, particularly in the Japanese American the domestic political context of Taiwan Revolution Draft. In the U.S. also, China is perceived with both with as a country with great potential, but then also with great risk. And particularly if you talk more, with, if you spend more time with the Department of Defense and the military-affiliated people, you'll get the more sense of a heightened sense of concerns about the Chinese intentions and capabilities. If you follow through, it only is apparent if you just read the only executive summary of the annual report that the Pentagon does and submit to the U.S. Congress on capability of the People's Liberation Army. And in these annual reports, it really chronicles how steadily China has been modernizing its forces, sometimes to the disadvantage of the critical technical and military tactical advantage that the United States military thought that it had, and how quickly China is really narrowing that gap, and what U.S. should do about it. And also, U.S., especially military defense establishment, has been watching very closely the Chinese behavior and the issues of South China Sea. They watched very closely how China reacted right after the 2010 Singapore Island incident, fishing trawlers incident, and the official statement that comes out of Chinese leadership in terms of its core security interests and its statement on the first island chain, second island chain, and so forth. But as much as greatly concerned the United States may be about Chinese concern, Chinese intentions and capabilities in the area of security issues, U.S. also shares that complexity with Japan, that the U.S. also is very dependent on the China in terms of its economy. China now holds, I believe, the largest amount of U.S. debt and also treasury bond. So in terms of trade and trade finance and general economy, U.S. also can really not live without China. But then China also cannot really live without U.S. market either. So there again, you see economic dependence on one hand, but the mutual security concerns and the strategic distrust on the other. And in the United States case, Taiwan Relations Act and its strategic ambiguity that it has taken is in relations that in its relations with Taiwan, and also how it manages that relation as it tries to forge what Obama administration nowadays calls a constructive, cooperative, and comprehensive relationship with China is a very complicated issue in terms of American U.S. domestic politics. We all read and hear a lot about the U.S. government's annual decision on the Taiwan military sales and the reasoning and the diplomatic talks that goes on between D.C., Washington, and Beijing very quietly. But then at the same time, U.S. tried to reassure Taiwanese that it is really committed to the defense of Taiwan if Taiwan is subject to a unilateral act of military aggression and military unification. So in case of a security relationship between the United States and China, and also Japan and China, they're complex for similar reasons. But for the United States, because China also is the member of the Permanent Five at the United Nations Security Council, there are other diplomatic issues that are bigger than East Asia that requires the Chinese, if not cooperation, acquiescence to U.S. policy. So that also complicates Washington's relationship with Beijing. But as I listened to Dr. Matsuda's presentation, there are a couple of questions that came to my mind. So I would just like to finish my comment out with those. First is, I was very intrigued about the scenarios that Dr. Matsuda put out for China and Japan's future. And I wonder if he could elaborate on, out of those four scenarios, which one of those four scenarios are deemed most likely in each country's perspective, Japan and China. And secondly, since he really literally hops off the plane from Tokyo this morning, I would also be curious to his view on how Japanese public attitude has been shifting toward China. From looking outside from the United States, China doesn't seem to be able to redeem itself in terms in the eyes of Japanese public, especially after the fishing trawlers incident in fall of 2010. And it's almost as if, just in reading news commentaries and such, it gives me the impression that politically, it's very difficult for Japanese government officials and political leaders to talk anything constructive or positive relationship about China. And that I wonder if my understanding of it is completely off the mark, more or less accurate, or somewhat in the middle. Thirdly, since he's one of the best China watcher that Tokyo has nowadays, I would also be curious to know his thoughts on the upcoming leadership transition in China and its potential impact on the short term, the Chinese behavior in the security issues. And lastly and finally, there has been some questions regarding the Chinese civilian leadership's control over the PLA activities. And what is Japan's China Watch's view on that? Whether they are greater concerns about civilian leaders in China and their ability to control the PLA and PLA and having more and more of the political will and intention, and it's not hesitant to not to listen to the civilian leadership's calls for restraint. So with that,
thank you very much. These four questions are all very difficult. But okay, let me try to elaborate. After I answer her question, I'd like to discuss with four. Okay. For the first question, which scenario of the four scenarios is likely? Actually, scenario plannings are not done for foreseeing the future. These scenarios are in your mind, people's mind. How do you see China? Or how do you see other countries? When you have this image, then you will have different, you will have a certain views on that China. So these are, China images which Japanese have in the past history. So I haven't created this for foreseeing the future. For example, now people are worried about hegemonic power. China is modernizing and becoming much more unilateral. This is the nightmare. Okay. So this is the China image in the present. But China may collapse next year. We don't know. But the important thing is that the Japanese people have this kind of image now. And the policymakers and the Japanese public will make action based on this image. So this image plays a role. So this is my intention. And actually, talking about this scenario, actually, cooperative China is not that ideal for Japan, because this will be G2 world. Japan will be left behind. The United States and Japan, the United States and China will decide every important thing in Asia. So sometimes when the relations between the United States and China become very good, the Japanese people begin to worry. When China behaves unilaterally like this, you know, people have this kind of image. So I'm sorry, I don't say which is spiky. But for China's view, I think that Chinese people now think that Japan is declining, definitely. But as China declines, as Japan declines, Japan will be potentially the United States. I think that this is the image held by the weak alliance. This is the image held by the specialists and policymakers. But the public still has have this kind of image, revival militarism. Still have this kind of image. So there are the image toward Japan is split. If Japan revives, for example, Japan's economy will boom next year on, then strong alliance, this kind of image will come back. A second question. I think that you said that the, you know, any trend in Japanese, yeah, and any constructive things in terms of the regulations are not welcome.
Atmosphere.
In a sense, yes, but because Japanese public feeling for China is already a little bit recovered. In 2011, it hit the bottom. If my memory is correct, the people, those who have affinity for China, was only 12% in 2011. It was more than 70% high in the 1980s. At that time, it was the friendship between Japan and China period. But now it's less than 20, always. Now it's a little bit recovering because the incident passed already. So a little bit recovering. However, I don't think that it will recover to the 30% and 40%. Maybe it will last less than 20%. So in a sense, you're right. The decision makers do not dare to appease China. But on the other hand, the Japanese people do not want troubles with China. So, for example, the famous Nagoya mayor, Mr. Kawamura, said that there wasn't a Nanjing atrocity. It didn't happen, he said, courageously. and made a very big trouble between Nanjing and Nagoya. These are friendship cities, but the old exchanges are whole now. And it became a serious issue between both countries. And this kind of thing, trouble, I think that most of the Japanese public do not want to see. And a lot of citizens in Nagoya got mad at their own mayor. So I think that the Japanese public still has a kind of, sense of balance. They want stable, good relations with China, but they don't want appeasing China. This is my sense. The third one is the leadership change in China. I think that during the leadership change, Chinese behavior will become very, very cautious, and very few new changes will occur. And because China's politics has already become bureaucratic politics, the bureaucracy doesn't want changes, especially in the process of leadership change. people tend to be very much conservative. Never say new things. Look at Xi Jinping. He has never said any new things. So I think that China's behavior will become much more conservative. But the very risky thing is that when the Chinese public feel that they were insulted, some events, very bad incident happens, suppose. Then, since their activities, their behavior becomes very conservative, they may become very much assertive. So, in ordinary life, they become very much conservative. But, you know, if something big thing happens, I think China's behavior will become very much uncertain. The fourth, does civilian control PLA well? I think that China has a very bad system to control the military. If you take a look at the Central Military Commission, there is only one or two civilian leaders, chairman and vice general, so far. Sometimes only chairman, and others are all military guys. And they speak with some military jargons, and maybe the chairman doesn't understand really well. But, you know, this is the reality. And the chairman has to sign the documents or stamp in Chinese way. I don't know, but he has to sign the documents, and he has to be briefed all those, you know, important military activities. But I really doubt the civilian chairman, now the Hu Jintao, next, Xi Jinping, fully understand the political and international influence of Chinese every military behavior. For example, anti-satellite ASAP test, which was done in 2008 or 2007. I don't have a good memory, but I believe that Hu Jintao was briefed. It's a very big incident, but he didn't. I guess that he didn't really understand the meaning of the test. So the system itself has a very big problem. And nowadays, the PLA has many activities, and they are not well controlled by the civilian governments. Why? Because China has its own principle on sovereignty. For example, Taiwan is a part of China. Senkaku is a, Yaoyudao is a sacred part of China territory. The whole Southeast China Sea is China's water. These are their principles, but the reality they face is quite different from their principles. So there is a gap. And policies should be done based on the reality. Otherwise, China has to launch a war. But there are many principles. So the local military or any other on the ships from the maritime related organization can cause trouble and try to drag the central government policy from the reality level to the principle level. Because the principle, you cannot deny principle on sovereignty. So they can influence the central government policy. So then they can increase their own budget. This is my hypothesis. And the military personnel have many great, sometimes quite different discourses from the central government. Why? This is also a kind of freedom of speech. I don't think so. But if we carefully look at those military guys, for example, Guo Yuan, General Guo Yuan and Zhu Chenghu. Their father or grandfather are great guys. The service chief. So I think that the military cannot punish them, even if they speak, you know, different from the central government. So they can be bold. They can boldly speak different things. And people welcome them. So it seems that, you know, the PLA you know, discourse, PLA's views on international relations become very assertive, different from the government. Actually, they are almost half retired. They are not in the in charge of the operations inside the military. So they are a little bit different. So I think that there are many, many different levels of discussions. Thank you. Yeah. Do you have any questions? Okay, you first.
This is kind of regarding, I guess, if there is
a
future payment route from the Tiananmen Space Program, regarding the Japanese and U.S. responses to Chinese A2AD capabilities, whether there's any divergence there in the alliance. You mentioned briefly, you know, that Japan has fears of entrapment and abandonment, not exactly this word, but roughly. And I guess there seems, you know, the U.S. developing certain concepts like air sea battle and so on, right? That there's obviously the danger that the U.S. is more concerned with, say, you know, a high-end conflict with China, whereas Japan is concerned with a range of scenarios that could be including incursions in Senkakus or coercion, you know, not just war. And I was wondering how you thought, you know, those divergent kind of concerns and interests could be reconciled together. Especially because obviously both are members of the alliance and both are probably developing some response to the Chinese capabilities. Do you see any approach that successfully reconciles problems in there? What do you think the prospects
of that? I'm sorry, my memory is very short, so I'll do that one by one. Sorry. You know, the air sea battle concept here has not been mature. And A2AD, this concept is also named by the Americans. Chinese have never said that. So this is still in the discussion level. But my view is that as for the United States, area denial is, or anti-access is that they're trying to access this. They're trying to access, and China will try to deny U.S. access. But as for Japan, it's a territorial defense. So the analogy, this is a kind of analogy of the Cold War period. So Japan has to come back to territorial defense. That's my image. So after during the post-Cold War period, the U.S.-Japan alliance is described as a global partnership, and we have to do this and that, and there are many items list, but list of items. But you know, anti-A2AD strategy is as for Japan is territorial defense. So it's this is my image, and I don't know whether they have already started concrete negotiation or coordination about that. I'm sorry, not that clear.
Are we introducing ourselves? Steve Winters, local researcher, and actually a former foreign researcher at Kyoto University. I thought you gave a very good summary of most of the aspects. But I just wondered, I've tried to figure out how to ask this question, but some people say, for example, World War II was basically a war of industrial mobilization. I mean, the fact that the U.S. could convert their automobile factories into producing armaments, I mean, it was a massive effort to I mean, the question was which country could actually mobilize their industrial base And then probably since then we've had, the question is which country can mobilize our technological base, but they're probably looking towards a future. There's a lot of talk about cyber warfare, X, Y, and Z. The question is which countries are in a position to actually make a leap into, you know, like unforeseeable new methods of warfare. And probably you would have to rate Japan as one of the most likely countries to be having various secret projects underway. I mean, every country does, but with a chance of success. For instance, I was very surprised when I was in Japan at the time, and it's still the case, when the cold fusion was laughed out of the universities in the U.S. to find out that the Toyota Motor Company was actually had hired all the people who had been thrown out of the cold fusion research, and they were all working for Toyota under the guise of the Minoru Toyota Foundation. But I mean, just crazy project, shall we say. So how do you rate that factor in there? Because I'm sure any serious Japanese person in the defense establishment would have to be thinking along those lines too, and would have to have an estimate of what their chances were versus China. And you mentioned all the mutual spying, which is clearly related to such things. I mean, is that a factor at all in your thinking? Secret projects, forget the
spying. Secret projects. If I know that, it's not a secret. but anyway, Japan may have done some secret project, but I think that in Japan, transparency is too high, and it's really difficult to do.
Well, we could give a recent example at the supercomputer conference. You know, Japan sprung their new supercomputer, the K computer, in Kobe with the 10 petaflop operation. Apparently, this was a total surprise to everybody else that they suddenly leaped ahead by a factor of at least 5 in the world supercomputer list. So, I mean, even that's not a very high secret, but it was an example. It was an example of something that surprised the other researchers, and that is along the line of what I'm talking about.
I think every private company, or if there is a competition, there should be a secret development. I don't know much about. I'm sorry.
I'm Gil Rosman from Princeton University, and I have a question about your conclusions. What should Japan do? You say Japan's been reactive; it wants stability, and yet people see a hegemonic China. So what should Japan do? You didn't really say much about that. And I'll specifically ask you about territorial issues. On the one hand, China is pressing the Senkaku Gyalu issue. On the other hand, these other territorial issues are bedeviling Japan's relationship with South Korea and Russia. Does Japan have strategic thinking to deal with these issues with the other countries in order to improve its chances of cooperation and for dealing with China, particularly with South Korea? You may have seen the recent book by Togo Kazuhiko. It just came out, in which he argued strongly that Japan must make progress on territorial issues in order to have strategic progress in Asia.
It's a tough question, too. Disputes, Japan has different positions. And realities are also different. For example, in the Northern Territory and Takeshima doctor issue, other sides rule those islands effectively. But in the Senkaku issue, Japan rules islands, the islands effectively. And also, Japan does not recognize that there is a territorial issue with China. But Japan claims Northern Territory and Takeshima. So the situations are very much different. And if, having said that, if Japan has makes one single concession, give away, for example, 2 islands out of 4 in Northern Territory, I think that it will influence other
So I think that's very, very difficult for Japanese politicians to take initial action. So only a very strong leadership can make this decision. And you know, maybe the Northern Territory is the least difficult one, but others are quite difficult.
Mike Billington, I'm with Executive Intelligence Review. I want to ask you about the anti-missile defense and the pivot in terms of those who see the pivot as a intentional attempt to confront China from the U.S. As you probably know, the U.S. deployment of anti-missile defense around Russia in Europe has caused an enormous conflict with Russia. And recently, the Russian chief of staff, in expressing their view about this as a provocation, said that the same issues exist in Asia. And he didn't elaborate, but I'm wondering if you might have some comments on whether there is an expanded surrounding of China and Russia by the U.S. in terms of anti-missile defense, and how you view the so-called pivot in the buildup of U.S. military presence in Australia and potentially the Philippines as dragging Japan into a confrontational alliance against China.
This is people never ask easy questions. as for Japan, you know, the missile defense was Japan was motivated mainly by North Korea missile threat, and China is a kind of hidden agenda. And in the early stage, the people inside the Japan Defense Agency at that time, especially the uniformed people, were very much negative about missile defense because it won't work effectively at that time. But at that time, China opposed harshly. Very much, because China concerned about Taiwan issue. If China, because China is building a lot of missiles targeting Taiwan, and if United States and even Japan will try to support Taiwan by missile defense, because missile defense system should be shared by many countries. It's not a standalone system. It should be supported by the United States and maybe hiddenly. Secretly supported by Japan. That's the China's concept at the time. Since China opposed very much, Japan began to realize that this will work. This will work. Because ballistic missiles are political and psychological weaponry. And missile defense is also the same. So, Japan began to understand the importance of missile defense. When other side tries to threaten you by using the missile, the ballistic missiles, whether you have missile defense or not, make a very big difference. Right? So this is also, led by U.S. Decision making, but this is also Japan's own decision making. And China learned this logic, so became very silent about this compared to the 1990s. So I think that the games are quite different in Asia and Russia. And China has not multiply the number of the ballistic missiles either, because China's missile technology is not that high. Since they don't have enough good capability, they do not simply increase the number of missiles. And if China makes a decision to increase the number of the missiles
hostile.
I think that China will step, take the same step, which the Soviet Union did. And the Chinese decision makers and specialists know the danger of this step very well. So far, they develop a certain amount, certain kind of capability, and Japan and other countries have a certain kind of capability. But discussions are not hindered. This is the situation. I think that the situation is quite different from the world.
How about the pivot in terms of the Japanese view of whether this is creating an anti-China?
Pivot is not a welcomed word. It's not a perfect one. In my shallow understanding, that during the Bush administration, the United States has made a very negative impression that China and U.S. Concerns are shifted toward Middle East or Afghanistan. And Asia is U.S. is absent. Actually, the United States has never left Asia. However, the impression already existed. So, try to exaggerate or refocus the U.S. presence. The United States is using the pivot. But it's not a good word. A lot of people criticize this word. I don't think it's the best word either.
One more, last one.
We can talk
privately. I'm Jing from Formosa Association of Public Affairs. You mentioned that Taiwan-Japan relationship has been good, but do you think it's more on the civilians level? Because as recent as March 11, the Prime Minister didn't let Taiwan representative go up, and we see the flowers, and there was some incident over there, and so I wonder what you would do.
Yes, you're right. The Japan-Taiwan relations are basically very, very good in the people-to-people basis. And if Taiwan is taken as a kind of state, it has a state status, then China will oppose and make a criticism. So the Japanese bureaucracy tries to keep a distance from that kind of status, state status. That happens many, many times. And I think that since Japan and Taiwan doesn't have diplomatic relations, there is a rationale to do so. However, the cases which happened during the earthquake, that kind of humanitarian relief cases. I think that Japan should show its flexibility. Similar things happen everywhere. In New Zealand, Christchurch, at that time, the Prime Minister didn't see the rescue team from Taiwan. This kind of thing. I don't think it's people and the government should show some kind of flexibility. This is my personal opinion.
We can continue forever, but I think time is up. I would like to thank all of you for your active participation, and let's
I'm in a transition from retirement. I was looking at Paul.